हरिओम। विशल चांट वर्स नंबर 29। बुद्धेर भेदं धृतेश्चैव गुणतस्त्रिविधं शृणु प्रोच्यमानमशेषेण पृथक्त्वेन धनंजय। दिस चैप्टर बिगिन्स विथ अर्जुनस क्वेश्चन अबाउट the exact meaning of sannyas and tyaga, and Bhagwan gives various opinions, and then finally he says that yajna dana tapak karma should be performed without attachment to the karma as well as to the results of action. That itself is sattvic tyaga. Thereafter he went to analyze the action, how it happens. There are five main causes, Bhagwan says, for because of which action happens, and in those five, Atma is not included. So only by ignorance, because of ignorance, one assumes that I, the self, is the cause or is the doer of action. But when one comes to recognize in the state of meditation, when one comes to recognize that I am the witness, consciousness, and I am not the doer, that all actions happen according to the qualities of this prakriti, gunas, that I am just a witness in this whole process, when one comes to recognize this, one becomes free from all bondage of action. That itself is called moksha. So in order to become free, we have to go through the process of karma yoga, etc., which is fulfilling our duties without attachment. So to make it more easy to comprehend, Bhagwan then further says that we have these three types of vision, and based on those vision, we perform karmas, which are also of three types, and there are three types of doers. So if this 3-3-3 can be made more and more sattvic, then our ordinary karma will become karma yoga. And that is very beautifully presented. And now Bhagwan says that you should also understand the role of buddhi and dhriti. Buddhi means the instrument with which we understand. All our understanding happens because of the use of our buddhi. And that also then modifies our personality, the karta, it modifies the karma, it modifies the jnanam. Everything can be modified, transformed, if the buddhi is used effectively. So there is a very important role for this buddhi, a power of discrimination and power to think and arrive at understanding. And the buddhi is such that once it has understood something, it becomes, it is partial to the understanding. It prefers that which is right, which is true. It is very difficult to go against the buddhi. Then it influences our mind, it influences our senses also. So it is very important that buddhi understands the everything properly. Then it is easier to influence our emotions and action. For example, once the buddhi understands, like in the good old days, even the earth, that it is spherical, was not known. But then once the intellect understood through experimentation and all, then it is accepted Even our experience might be different. Our experience is a flat earth only, but intellect has understood, so it is accepted then. So it is very important. But apart from understanding, what we require is the perseverance to follow our path, dhruti. Dhruti also plays a very important role. So the three types of buddhi and three types of dhruti, Bhagavan says, I will explain to you. You please listen. So prochyamanam asheshena prathaktvena dhananjaya. Hey Dhananjaya, please listen carefully the different types of buddhi and dhruti. So first he talks about buddhi. Verse number 30. Pravrittincha nivrittincha karya karye bhaya bhaye bandham mokshan cha ya vetti buddhi sa partha satviki prarittincha nivrittincha karya karye bhaya bhaye bandham mokshan cha ya vetti. That buddhi, which through its thinking and analysis and comparison comes to understand the following, that buddhi is considered sattvic. See, buddhi also needs help, so the scriptures can help the buddhi to think. Because we need some data, some facts to think. So the scriptures also help to think. Then through satsang, through our own contemplation, we come to the understanding. So when we use our power of thinking rightly, properly, according to the praman means of knowledge, then we arrive at right understanding. If our means of knowledge is faulty, then we can't come to a proper understanding. If, for example, if I want to see color, then eyes are the means. So if there is some defect in my eyes or the light and all is not proper, then I cannot arrive at proper understanding of the color. We go to buy some clothes and all because of all sorts of funny lights which they put, you feel that is what the color looks like. But when you bring it home, it appears totally different. So if the lights are playing some tricks or the eyes are playing tricks, then the understanding will not be proper, because the understanding of color is based on the praman, the means of knowledge, which are the eyes. Similarly, to understand what is the main important facts of life, the praman are the scriptures. Like Bhagavad Gita, the Upanishad. Like if you want to know something about science and all, we have the scientific manuals and books, or scientists are there who are like praman. Similarly, for understanding the fundamentals of life, scriptures like Bhagavad Gita is the praman. So using the scriptures, when the buddhi thinks and arrives at the understanding, the following understanding, then that buddhi is called sattvic. So what are the understanding which is important here? So first, it's like a set. Bhagavan says, pravrittim cha nivrittim cha. The buddhi which understand pravritti and nivritti. These are also technical words. Pravritti means action which leads us into the world more and more. Pravritti Marga it is called. The path of action leading one into more and more worldly entanglements. And Nivritti means path of withdrawal from the world, which ultimately leads to moksha, which leads to enlightenment. So path of going out and path of coming in. For example, if there is a circle and the center is there, actually the center is like our own self, but we are at present somewhere away from it, on the periphery, on the circumference. So there are two main ways in which one moves. One is away from the center and one is towards the center. When one moves toward the center, one comes to the point, I mean the center. When one goes away from the center, where that fellow will go, nobody can tell. Buddhi is the one who analyzes life in depth and studies the scriptures and understands that this is the path of pravritti. If I follow this path, it will take me more and more into this samsara only. And Buddhi also understands that this is the path of nivritti. This will bring me closer and closer to my own self, ultimately leading to the state of enlightenment. Like in case of Gautam Buddha, he was there in the world and a prince, and his father was planning for his worldly life. And it would have been the pravritti marga for him. But then he stopped at one point and started thinking, and then understood that is not path for me. My path is this nivritti. So he withdrew himself from the worldly things and reached the core, the center. It depends on how far we are from the center because of our confusion, ignorance. That path we have to take slowly and steadily, like karma yoga, bhakti, jnana, dhyana, will take us slowly towards center. And as we come closer and closer to our center, we will feel more joy and more peace. Unconditional joy and unconditional peace are the signs of coming closer to your own self. It's like we are going toward the Himalayas. The more we go, the more the weather or the temperature and all, we can see the changes. And as you climb, the pressure and all keep on decreasing and all. So similarly, we know that we are going climbing. Similarly, when we follow the path of nivritti, one experiences more and more joy and more unconditional peace. So one knows that one is withdrawing and moving towards the self. See, even those who are at the periphery, they are also seen in the world, and those who move toward the center, they are also seen. Not that withdrawal means one has to go into the Himalayas or something, but it is a subtler path wherein our inner personality moves towards our real self. So the buddhi, our own intellect, which after the study of the scriptures through satsang comes to understand this very clearly, that this is the path of pravritti which will lead me into samsara, and this is the path of nivritti which will lead me to enlightenment, that is called sattvic buddhi. See, it is a test. Just like we go to school and college and we study there, but just going to school and college studying itself is not any guarantee that we have understood. So we have a test, we have to give the test. Right? And if we pass in the test or score proper in the test, that means we have understood. Similarly, just because we are able to use our buddhi in so many other fields, doesn't mean we are buddhiman. The real test of buddhi is, are you able to understand? You are moving in life, are you able to understand this movement of yours? Will it take you to enlightenment or will it take you to more and more bondage? If that is understood, then your buddhi is sattvic. what is rajasic and tamasic we will see. So you yourself have to select. Arey, mera to ye lagta hai. So this is one pair. Then another thing which the buddhi should be able to recognize is karya and akarya. Means what are my responsibilities or duties and what are not my duties. That also our own buddhi should be ultimately be able to answer. See, there are various points which help us to determine what are my duties. One is we have to take, first of all, take the help of the scriptures, which tell us whether they are, what are the duties and what are the values which we should have while fulfilling the duties and all. But other things which we can take help are the masters, the wise people who are following this path of goodness. We can take their help. Wise people of the present time and also of the ancient time. Through their stories and all, we can take help of them. Then we have to also, what you call, ultimately take the help of our own conscience. See, this is also mentioned in our scriptures, that after taking help of the scriptures, the wise people and everything, we have to also ask our own conscience whether you agree with this or not. And if our conscience also agrees, what we call our inner voice, if our conscience also agrees, then that is our duty. Then that we have to pursue. So this also has to be comprehended by the intellect. Okay, this is my duty and this is not my duty. See, our duty is called our swadharma. And that which is not my duty is, it can be paradharma, somebody else's duty. See, Bhagwan has said before also, and I think in this chapter, I don't remember, also it will be said, that it is better to fulfill your own duties well. Even not well, but it is not advisable to fulfill somebody else's duty. Paradharmo bhayavah, swadharme nidhanam shreyah, paradharmo bhayavah. So paradharma is somebody else's duty. Adharma is unrighteousness. But swadharma is my own duty. So an intellect which can tell me that this is my duty. Duty, as I said, is very very broad vision we should have. We have duty towards our own self, towards the family, towards the society, towards the world, towards our nation, towards nature, towards gods, towards the past, Rishi Munis, towards our ancestors. So all this we have to comprehend in a very holistic way and understand. See, each person's understanding of one's duty might be narrow and very broad. So a person who can comprehend the duties well,